So in this picture, we've got a pregnant mom and a little fetus inside of her uterus. That's the name of this little chamber that the fetus is hanging out in. And this uterus is an organ, and women have this organ, and it's a very, very strong organ, a very muscular organ. In fact, if you've ever gone to a delivery and you've heard people kind of chant, "Push, push, push," they're literally kind of, encouraging mom to push down on this uterus and help the baby come out into the world. So this uterus is the room in which the baby lives, but the environment in which the baby lives is actually very different as well from how we live outside, in the sense that there's amniotic fluid in this space, right? Amniotic fluid, and the baby is actually swimming in this fluid for months at a time. So for 9 months, baby is swimming in amniotic fluid, and that brings up some obvious questions. How is baby able to breathe or eat? How does it take care of its needs? So let's think about what those needs are. Let's enumerate them. One of them is oxygen. So, how does the baby take in oxygen if it's not getting it from the lungs? And the lungs are actually full of amniotic fluid, by the way. How is it able to get nutrients? Things like sugar or glucose that it needs for energy. So I'll put example glucose. How about let's think about waste. How does it get rid of things like carbon dioxide? For us, it's very easy. We just kind of exhale or take a breath out. But how does a baby do that? If I just said that the lungs are full of fluid, how does it get rid of waste products like carbon dioxide? And it turns out all of these kinds of issues are obviously very important, and the mom and the baby kind of work together a solution. And this is the first kind of chance for mom and baby to really work together on something. And the solution is something called the placenta. The placenta. And you may have heard of the placenta. And the baby actually sends a couple of vessels up to the placenta. And these are little umbilical arteries. And also sends up an umbilical vein to the placenta. And the vein brings blood back from the placenta. And all of these vessels, all three of these, kind of make what we call the umbilical cord. So you may have heard of the umbilical cord, and now you know what's inside of it. The umbilical cord, actually, if you were to cut it, I'm just going to show you what it would look like if you were to cut across it. It's actually kind of an easy thing to remember because it has a big floppy little vessel right here, and that's the umbilical vein. That's the umbilical vein. And it's got oxygen, and that's why I'm drawing it as red, even though it's a vein, because it's coming back to the heart, so that's why we call it a vein. And you've got umbilical arteries, and these two actually don't have too much oxygen. And that's why I'm drawing them in blue, just to show that they're low in oxygen. But they're called umbilical arteries because they're going away from the heart. So the umbilical arteries and the umbilical vein look like this, and actually they're not just freely floating out there. They're actually encased in this jelly, and the jelly is called Wharton's jelly. I'm actually just going to redraw this just to show you how I remember this, because sometimes it's hard to remember if there's one artery or two arteries. And I kind of think of the mouth as a vein and or a V. And I think of the eyes as two little A's. So that's my little trick for remembering that there are two umbilical arteries and one umbilical vein, and that they're all encased in the Wharton's jelly. And this is the umbilical cord, right? So this is kind of the overall picture, but now I want to kind of go into some detail to really get us to understand how the placenta works, because it honestly is one of the most interesting organs in the sense that it allows us to do things that we simply cannot do today. But we could do for many, many months at a time. So I'm going to invert the way that I drew this. So I drew this kind of one way above, and I think you'll see how I flipped it around here. This will be the uterine wall. And again, remember the uterine wall is kind of a nice, strong, muscular wall. And let me label it so it's clear. This is uterine, or I'll just call it uterus, the wall of the uterus anyway. And on the insides, you've got actually, working from the outside in, let me draw some of mom's blood vessels. So she's got some blood vessels coming up like this, and this is a little uterine artery. And this, of course, gives oxygen to the uterus. We said it's a big muscle, so it definitely needs blood vessels like arteries and veins. And I'll draw a couple of them. Let's draw another uterine artery over here, and I'll draw one third one over here. And of course, there are many more than three, but I just want to kind of give you the concept that there are some uterine arteries, and there are also some uterine veins. Let me draw some uterine veins as well, and I'll draw one over here. So these blue ones are the uterine veins. I'll label this one over here. So what they're doing is they're actually going through a layer of tissue. So let me draw in a layer of tissue for you so you see exactly what I mean. There's a layer of tissue here, and they're kind of going through it. And this layer of tissue is mom's tissue. So actually, I'm going to label it mom's tissue, or I'll just call it mom's. And it looks a little bit, you have to stretch your imagination, but it looks a little bit like a plate. So this entire thing that I'm shading in red is one of the parts of the placenta. So we've already kind of started drawing the placenta. And this part is known, actually let me switch colors. This part is known as the basal plate. So if they're talking about the basal plate, you're talking about this bit of tissue here with the blood vessels, the uterine arteries and the uterine veins. And just to be kind of clear, it belongs to mom. So this is mom's cells. And now we get into some really fun stuff. So this, all these uterine arteries, they kind of squirt out blood. And they don't go into, you know, any other vessel. They actually just kind of squirt out blood into an open area. So let's say there's a red blood cell here. This red blood cell literally could touch, physically touch, a red blood cell over here. They literally just could come up and meet and maybe shake hands, and then they could then go down the veins. So this is really, really different from how we usually think about blood cells traveling always within a vessel, because here it's kind of a pool, and you have this kind of circulation that happens because you have these red blood cells kind of, as I've drawn them, kind of going up into the middle and then circulating into the veins. So you have this interesting circulation where you basically have blood coming up through the arteries and down into the veins. And the way I think about this, and you can maybe choose your own kind of analogy, but for me, I think of it a little bit like a hot tub. And the uterine arteries are like the jets of water kind of coming up. And the blue veins, the uterine veins, are literally like the drains in the hot tub. So it becomes almost like a swirling pool of red blood cells. Now, importantly, these red blood cells have with them oxygen, they have nutrients, so they have a lot of the stuff that our fetus is interested in getting access to. So let's switch gears, let's think about our fetus. Our fetus has got, we said, a couple of umbilical arteries coming down, and I also said that they're coming down inside of this Wharton's jelly, right? This umbilical cord of Wharton's jelly. And actually what happens is that the vessels actually branch out and they split up. So the uterine arteries, they form lots and lots and lots of little branches, and I'm going to draw them in for you. And let's say that the branches go kind of all over the place. Let's say they go like this. Let's draw five or six branches over here, and let's draw some branches down on this side too. So you've got lots of branches off the uterine arteries, and they want access to the oxygen and nutrients. So guess what they do? They just kind of push in. In fact, you have little cells here. I'm going to draw some pushing in right here. You've got little cells that I'm drawing in white called trophoblasts. And they literally kind of do this. They just kind of push in. So these white cells are trophoblast cells. And they're good at invading. You could think of them as invading, or if you want to be less aggressive, you could think of them as being just curious. So these little fetus cells called trophoblasts start pushing in, and within the trophoblast is a little blood vessel. And this blood vessel now is in very close contact with mom's red blood cells, right? You've got red blood cells coming up alongside of it. And now what's going to happen through diffusion is that oxygen is going to go into the fetus's blood cell. So oxygen is going this way, as well as nutrients. So oxygen and nutrients go inside, and then you have carbon dioxide leaving. So carbon dioxide actually goes into the pool of blood. So it's a really, really kind of cool thing that the red blood cells aren't touching The mom's red blood cells are not touching baby's red blood cells because, of course, baby's red blood cells are within blood vessels, right? These are within blood vessels. These things right here are not open, they're closed vessels. And once that exchange happens, they continue to stay closed, and you get like a little capillary coming back. And of course, you've got capillaries coming back from every part of this, right? So all of these have been doing the same thing, kind of going inside of this pool of blood. And actually, it gets a little bit more complicated than the way I've drawn it. In fact, a more accurate drawing might be with more branching. You might have something like this, where it really kind of has lots of surface area and it comes back around. And you have the blue vessels kind of going into each one of these little finger-like projections. And you have a lot of gas exchange happening. So this would be maybe a better way of drawing it, but the concept is the same, right? You basically have all of this wonderful diffusion happening, and as a result, you actually have nice, rich, oxygenated blood returning to the baby. So this is finally allowing the baby to have access to oxygen and nutrients and get rid of its waste, its carbon dioxide. And so each one of these is actually doing the same thing with red or oxygenated blood coming back. And instead of having two vessels, it all kind of dumps into one vessel down the middle. And this vessel, as we already know, is called the umbilical vein. So this is actually the umbilical vein. Now, if we called the bottom one the basal plate, then of course you're guessing that there must be some name for this. And this, of course, has its name called the chorionic plate. Chorionic plate. And this one, you can already tell, this has all the cells from the fetus. So this belongs to the fetus. So you've got some tissue that belongs to the fetus. That would be the chorionic plate and all of its contents. You've got some tissue that belongs to mom. That's the basal plate. And then you've got some shared tissue or space in here because all of these little projections, all these little projections belong to the baby, but the actual pool, this pool of blood that's circulating, that pool of blood belongs to mom. So really, the placenta is a combination of all of these things. So I kind of think of the placenta then as kind of the first time that mom and baby work together for a common purpose.